Hi, my name's Andrew Ebisu. I'm a filmmaker based in Melbourne. I've made a series of movies on Fukushima Beach to highlight the great peril that is emanating from Fukushima. We really need to get the word out there. So please watch this movie, please remix it, burn copies, and just freely distribute it. Now please support me as a filmmaker by considering purchasing a copy of this movie. There'll be details in the box below. All my movies are put on YouTube for free. So if you could support my channel and me as a filmmaker in that way, that would be great. But please do share the movie and tell me what you think. Thank you all for watching, and wish you all a very good day.
Let me assure you, the situation is under control.
The latest result from Fukushima is the nuclear power plant suffered a 100% liquefaction. The core completely liquefied. There's nothing left. There's no hulk. There's no remaining collapsed core.
いたします。それではクアラルンプールまでの空の旅、どうぞごゆっくりお座りくださいませ。
A confluence of factors has brought me back to Japan, the country where I had spent 9 years of my life until leaving 4 years ago. I did not ever imagine that circumstances would permit me to see Japan again, especially since the events in Fukushima. Since the fallout from the meltdowns at the Daiichi nuclear plant, I had been advocating the evacuation of much of North and East Japan, including Tokyo. At the same time, the Japanese government has since been relentlessly pushing the incineration of radioactive waste across almost the entire country, and encouraging, and in many instances coercing its citizens, particularly some of its youngest, to consume radiation-tainted food. Official government radiation readings are notoriously benign, and official government radiation safety limits were raised notoriously high after the meltdowns. These official figures belie significantly higher readings done by concerned citizens, and reports of inexplicable illnesses, even cancers and deformities, even at this early stage of proceedings, only 2.5 years after the triple meltdowns. Cancers took 5 years to show up among residents around Chernobyl, evacuated even further out than those around Fukushima currently. With radioactive water and vapor leaking and emanating from 3 nuclear fuel reactor cores still boring into the soil, and the massive stack of cesium fuel rods still suspended 40 feet in the air in an earthquake, tsunami, and typhoon-prone sector of northern Japan, the sum of these fears, overwhelmingly, had dissuaded me from ever bringing my family back to Japan. In fact, these are not a summary of mere fears, but a summary of clear and present dangers, clear and present terrors that hound the largely unknowing, perhaps consciously unknowing, Japanese population. Governments around the world have been crushing people's freedoms and liberties to eradicate terrorism, but unfathomably they do not recognize the terrorism of uncontrolled and ongoing nuclear contamination moving east across the northern hemisphere from a beach in Japan. The nation of Japan seems to have embarked upon one huge scientific experiment, one that seeks to discover to what extent and for what length of time a large region of a marvelously populous nation-state can collectively live with and withstand unprecedented and uncontrolled daily doses of radiation, plutonium, cesium, strontium. The Pacific Ocean, North America, and the Northern Hemisphere have been signed up for this radiation deal as well. Ground zero for this experiment is not just Fukushima, but the great 30 million strong metropolis of Tokyo, which has been confirmed to have 5% higher levels of radioactive strontium in its tap water than even Fukushima itself. Numerous radiation hotspots dot the city, as well as reports of radiation-induced illnesses. Yet my short week-long stay in Japan is to be mainly confined to the Kansai region in western Japan, a region not as well known to foreigners, but just as enticing perhaps, more so than Tokyo ever was, as it encompasses, well it believes anyway, the heart and soul of the real Japan, as well as the great bulk of its rich ancient culture and history. Moreover, Kansai boasts a rare, rare jewel in the ancient and relatively unspoilt city of Kyoto, Japan's capital for 1,000 years. One could have thought that Kyoto and Kansai should have been spared much of the radiation, as they are relatively distant from Fukushima. No doubt the still very perilous state of the 4 reactor buildings and their hitherto uncooperative radioactive contents threatened them and the whole of Japan. Yet into this cauldron has been thrown the human element, or shall we say the inhuman element, the government, intervening, exacerbating the radiation dangers to the point where the ancient city may yet still be utterly destroyed.
I can't see any easy way of persuading the governments of the world and the scientific committees, the bogus scientific committees that they've set up to operate this system of chicanery and lies, any way of stopping them. I mean, to be honest, these people ought to be sent to jail. And perhaps one day that will happen. Who knows? But at the moment, I see no sign of them backing off from what is clearly a very, very serious problem. And in my opinion, probably the worst public health scandal in human history, and one that is very likely set on destroying all life on Earth if it's continued unabated. This is really a serious, serious problem. I mean, I'll give you an example, a very recent example of the sort of Alice in Wonderland world that we're living in with regard to radiation. Now, you will recall that the World Health Organization Supremo, a bloke called Wolfgang Weiss, Dr. Wolfgang Weiss, they had a meeting in 2012 to talk about the health effects of Fukushima. And, of course, they said there wouldn't be any. It wouldn't be any. There would be no detectable health effects. Now, what we discover in the last few months is that a study done by the medical university in Fukushima has turned up now, well, originally 27 cases of thyroid cancer in children, and it's now gone up to 44 cases of thyroid cancer in children. This is an official study. Now, the university department which made this study, they say, I mean, and it's quoted in the Japan Times, they say, we do not see that these thyroid cancers are associated with the Fukushima contamination. I mean, can you imagine such nonsense? Now, the actual background rate for thyroid cancer in Japan, I've dug out, it's actually zero. Now, so this was a study done in 2005. And if we, my colleague, Professor Michael Malko of the Institute of Power in Belarus, worked on the increases in thyroid cancer in Chernobyl, and he was able to determine a rate, a pre-Chernobyl rate in thyroid cancer in children. And it was something like 3 cases in 16 years in the whole population of Belarus, okay? Now, therefore, it's easy to work out that the excess risk in Fukushima of thyroid cancer in children is approximately 200 times the expected value. So it's not like 1.5 or 1.3 or 20% or something like that. It's about 200 times. But nobody's saying, oh gosh, we got it wrong. Oh dear, the internal radiation must be worse than we thought. Or any of this stuff. We hear a deadly silence from these people. They should all be sent to jail. I think it must be some kind of psychological denial. I think you'd probably better talk to sociologists and psychologists about this rather than to a scientist. I mean, I have thought about it, and I've thought of the various ways in which it can work. And I can step back from it and step back from it, and eventually we get back to a situation where it is really quite political. It's about the domination of one set of people by another set of people, and the wars and the lies and so on that have continued throughout the whole of history. And so in order to explain this, basically all you're doing is explaining all the things that have happened in history, which are equally insane, to be honest. We've had situations like this again and again throughout history, and this so therefore it's not really anything new there, except that in this case it's a question of the magnitude. It's a sort of third world war, isn't it? It's the governments versus the people. It's truly extraordinary.
A very generous family is hosting me in Nara City, just a short train ride south of Kyoto, and thus it is my home base for my stay. As I make my way to their house, my thoughts of radiation dissipate. I think only of how this used to be my home and how I have missed it. Even though at this point I have no Geiger counter, I see no sign and feel nothing of radiation, no mutations, no radioactive black dust. I had fears of such things being here, as one of my friends sent me an image of a terribly mutated flower from neighboring Kyoto 2 months before. I find myself even bemused at my radiation fears. It is believed that the freely roaming Nara deer are divine and thus afford divine protection to Nara itself. It seems on this inspection, this still seems strangely true, even after 311. I find here a place in Japan in which the Heian period, in many ways, has never really ended. No nuclear plague to be found. the only nefarious invasion by foreign bodies discernible is a jovial German folk-inspired brass band inexplicably promoting the coming of Nara Oktoberfest in June. As they incite the small crowd into a mild frenzy, I cannot help but think that this is a little bit like the general plight of Japan. The band playing on despite the dangers of Fukushima, despite the forced irradiation of Japanese in, as yet, unevacuated but radiation-affected areas of North Japan, despite the restart of nuclear reactors across Japan. The madness of government and vested interests ensuring with force and propaganda that while we work, drink and be merry, the business of nuclear power generation and the evidence of ensuing deaths and environmental destruction accompanying it are uninterrupted and unimpeded. I sense in Kansai, even in Tokyo, a level of antipathy to what is occurring in Fukushima, recently exposed in the prevalence of abnormal thyroid cysts shown in the documentary A2. By Ian Thomas Ash. It seems as if the radiation story has passed well beyond its attention cycle, like a seasonal festival or even like Oktoberfest. Everyone got together and really focused for a time, and then it all passed from memory, and therein lies the danger. In willful ignorance, the people of Japan, the people of the world, risk bringing on the annihilation of their own children, their own peoples and way of life. And this time, even Kyoto, the ancient capital, may not survive. One thing that is distinct about Kyoto is the abundance of traditional Japanese houses called machiya. They are characterized by wooden lattice windows and a second floor made of earthenware materials. The house forms a long, narrow rectangle shape leading out to a courtyard garden. The fact that these cultural treasures remain in Kyoto is largely due, though, to an American, Henry L. Stimson, the U.S. Secretary of War. In the closing months of World War II, the United States embarks upon the almost unfettered firebombing of Japanese cities. 100,000 Tokyo residents are killed, and 59% of Tokyo is destroyed in one raid in March 1945. City after city is subjected to this kind of incendiary bombing. These bombs ignited great fires that voraciously fed on the largely wooden buildings. Yet one urban target remains largely untouched, the city of Kyoto. Kyoto is continually struck off the target list through the personal intervention of Stimson. Looking at the city's elegant streets and the rich repository of culture it holds today, one can readily see how it may have affected Stimson when he had honeymooned there before the war. Millions of people have borne witness to Stimson's legacy as Kyoto is thronged by visitors with all its cultural treasures intact. As I make my way to meet a friend in Kyoto, I fear for what the Fukushima disaster may have wrought upon the city. Yet upon arriving in her town in Kyoto Prefecture, I see no evidence again of radiation, nor mutations, she reported to me back in April. Here, every spare space is seemingly devoted to growing something. The rice fields, the flowers, the agricultural produce all look quite normal. My Geiger counter reads 0.05 microsieverts an hour. Upon meeting my friend Eiko, I find all is not as it seems. She tells me that in March 2013, the governor of Kyoto approved the commencement of the burning of radioactive waste from the Fukushima area in Kyoto municipal incinerators. Locals, especially children, began to become sick, and there were elevated radiation readings in the prefecture. At 450 kilometers from Fukushima, Kyoto should have enjoyed a measure of protection from the radiation plume that largely blows around eastern and northern Japan and onto North America. The acceptance of this waste by the governors of Osaka and Kyoto and many other governors miles distant from Fukushima has brought the Fukushima radiation home to Kansai. Eiko took this photo of a flower on her balcony at this time. A former Tokyo resident, she moved to Kyoto in late 2011 to escape the radiation there, but then the government authorities ensured that the radiation followed her here. In May 1945, a target committee was commissioned by the US government to draw up a list of candidate cities to be subjected to the first offensive use of the atom bomb, born of the Manhattan Project. Of the four candidates, Kyoto was the most favored choice of the committee. It is surrounded by mountains that would focus the nuclear blast, and Kyoto produced some war material. But the major reason was that the people of Kyoto were judged to be the most sophisticated and educated in Japan, and therefore assessed to be the most able to understand the significance of the atom bomb where it dropped on them, thereby generating a greater spur for Japan's ultimate surrender, as the futility of fighting a nuclear-capable United States would then be apparent. As it turned out, Stimson was able to intervene again, and his city was removed from the atomic target list. Kiyomizu Temple lies on a mountain ridge on the eastern edge of Kyoto City. Visitors often take photos against this backdrop that overlooks Kyoto City. Had Kyoto been bombed, this would have been a terrifyingly impressive vantage point after the blinding flash. Such is the wrath and providence of history. Kyoto was spared by Stimson. Kokura was spared from atomic bombing by a heavy cloud on August 9, 1945. Hiroshima and Nagasaki were the cities that will forever be associated with the atomic bomb and the plague of radiation that followed. Come 2013, it is not American B-29s that threatens Kyoto with radiation, but in one of history's most sickening and twisted ironies, the radiation threat comes from Japanese government officials. At Kyoto Station in March 2012, they made their case that the incineration of Tohoku radioactive waste in Kyoto was safe. There were even several persons planted in the overwhelmingly angry crowd, holding up pro-incineration placards. Eiko tells me that she has not seen mutations or been witness to sick children since the cessation of waste burning at the end of this spring 2013. Yet the radiation is not really gone. It has largely escaped into the soil and biosphere in a gradual bioaccumulation. She tells me the incineration is scheduled to begin again just after I leave in late June. As it turns out, I really have arrived in Japan at the worst time to be hunting radiation and radioactive hotspots. Despite the monstrous radioactive plume emanating from Fukushima, and the continual leaks from the three devastated reactors into the Pacific Ocean, the greater menace at this time in mid-June is a monstrous seasonal typhoon tearing its way through Kyushu and southern Japan. So large are these typhoons that they render even more central Japanese cities such as Osaka and Tokyo on their periphery watery urban morasses. Only for a few hours a day is it not raining. I think to myself that it is safe to say that the typhoon is blowing the bulk of any radioactive plume out to the Pacific. As the rain drags on, I make my way by night bus to Tokyo, under cover of darkness, so to speak. I am a little nervous at the prospect of going there, and at the same time feel some self-loathing, as the radiation perhaps couldn't really be that bad. These are the kind of mind games I discover Eiko plays too. living in Kyoto. You know that the radiation is around somewhere, but you shut it out of your mind just to get on with those around you, dropping in and out of both a constant wariness and a lulled complacency several times a day. The apparent normalcy of life in Osaka and Kyoto makes inroads into my thoughts that Tokyo will be almost surely the same. In fact, Osaka and Kyoto seem to be experiencing somewhat of an economic mini-boom, as tourists from Asia are flocking to the area. Kansai International Airport brings in plane loads of visitors from Hong Kong and mainland China, attracted to the bustle and commerce of Osaka and the temples and shrines of Kyoto. But this belies a darker truth that is greatly due to the gradual and inexorable depreciation of the yen, spurred on by the rampant money printing of the Abe government. The TV news is permeated with reports of food price rises, coupled with the hiking of the consumption tax come July. Moreover, the influx of tourists here in Kansai is due to a silent consensus among them that the radiation in East Japan and in Tokyo is much greater than the government is conceding. Thus, these Chinese visitors are voting with their yuan, or currency exchanged yen, as to where it is truly safe to set foot in Japan. Not that Kansai is in any way immune to what is occurring in Fukushima. The reports from Fukushima tell of continuous and critical radioactive leakages that contaminate the groundwater, far around reaching well beyond Tokyo. Independent video reports reveal still astronomical radiation in areas well beyond the evacuation zone. Sterile external shots of the buildings at the Daiichi facility on the news tell nothing of the burning nuclear fuel inside and beneath them, nor of the radiation it is bringing to the people around the northern hemisphere. As my bus reaches in closer and closer to Tokyo, I remember how much has happened to the city since I left, and how much I have missed the place, and the guilt for being wary of it ever since 3/11. I'm awake to find that we are approaching Yokohama, a city in its own right, but often thought to be a glamorous satellite of Tokyo. Since the days after 3/11, I have thought the whole city to be a metropolis living on borrowed time, a complex leviathan, an economic, political, and cultural powerhouse of a city in decades of denial that it should have been relocated westward long ago, as it was settled on an active fault line. 3/11 only reinforced the folly of delaying the relocation much more. A government-commissioned scientific study in the days after 3/11 on the ramifications of the accident was suppressed by then Prime Minister Naoto Kan. The report, urgently prepared by the head of the Japan Atomic Energy Commission, Shunsuke Kondo, and submitted to the Prime Minister on March 26, 2011, recommended Tokyo and its suburbs be evacuated and the Daiichi nuclear facility abandoned if any of three events occurred: explosion in the reactor protective structures, complete reactor meltdowns, and structural failure in the cooling ponds. The events at Fukushima Daiichi fulfilled not merely one, but all three of these criteria, and yet Tokyo remains unevacuated. All news reportage from alternative media sources that is then followed up by mainstream sources 6 to 12 months later merely confirm in drab but nevertheless damning headlines. They tell of constant power failures, equipment failures, constant radioactive leaks, steam or water seeping into the ground and ocean. A concession has just been made that TEPCO must regularly dump radioactive water as it exceeds storage capacity regularly. All this peaceful-looking chaos management at a highly radioactive site is predicated on the hope of another earthquake not hitting the area for decades to come. As my bus reaches closer to central Tokyo, my Geiger counter merely registers 0.03 microsieverts an hour. Despite what I know to be true at Fukushima, I begin to feel that if there is radiation to be had here, I won't be finding it. My counter is less than ideal for radiation readings in soil. Tokyo soil that nuclear engineer Arne Gundersen tested to be of the grade of nuclear waste.
in 5 different sample locations in 2012. I alighted Ueno Station. Ueno Park is right by, a ripe candidate for some testing. Trudging around after another night of typhoon rain, the counter never gets beyond 0.05, even on the ground. Either the typhoon is blowing the airborne radiation away and is washing any surface radiation deeper into the soil, or we have a completely overblown and illusory radiation threat in Tokyo. Through the saturated Tori gates and down to Shinobazu Pond, Ueno is not revealing anything damning. It has, like Nara, perhaps stood still in space and time, oblivious to faraway man-made disasters. Making my way back up the hill, I find Ueno and Tokyo itself is starting to awake. People are making their way to and from the various museums located in and around the park. School children are filing in orderly hordes to Ueno Zoo from the train station. I notice the sky is becoming less overcast. It is warming up, and the sun is breaking the dominance of the typhoon for now. I let my feet dry a little and watch the kids beam past. It seems that as the typhoon tunes out, something powerful has moved back in. Something is exciting the Geiger counter. The counter can't distinguish between alpha, beta, and gamma rays, but within it, the tube of normally inert gas is being charged. Within the tube is a positively charged rod, and the tube itself is negatively charged. As ionizing radiation enters, the gas within it becomes ionized, with electrons making for the rod and ions for the tube wall. In the stampede each way, it creates a cascading current that the Geiger counter measures and displays on the screen. The counter suddenly reads 0.1 microsieverts an hour in the increasingly sunnier weather. As the number of children increase with the sunshine, the radiation seems to respond in kind. It seems I have found the radiation I have been looking for. These kids' young bodies are still developing rapidly, and hence they are the most vulnerable to the radiation present. One professor advised thus that children should not squat on the ground as is traditionally custom. It should alarm every parent in Kanto and North Japan, as their children inevitably will play daily in and encounter radioactive substances from Fukushima. Even though Naoto Kan did try to get more truth and accountability from TEPCO after the accident and has become somewhat of an anti-nuclear figure since his ousting as Prime Minister, the truth and veracity of the damning Kondo report calling for Tokyo's evacuation that Kan himself quashed is nevertheless becoming more and more difficult to dismiss. In this somewhat now notorious video, Steve Danieletto of Tokyo-based Metropolis magazine, written for foreigners in Japan, sought to reassure Tokyo Gaijin that all was well in the days after the Daiichi accident. He declared to a lot of willing believers that airborne readings of 0.26 microsieverts per hour were perfectly safe.
We're taking a look at the background levels of radiation in Tokyo. Currently, the levels are around about 0.2 microsieverts, which is the Tokyo normal level. Yesterday, it shot up to double, which is still very, very safe. It starts to get dangerous at about 4,000 to 40,000 times this level, and it becomes deadly at around about 5 to 10 million times this level. So we have nothing to worry about at the moment here in Tokyo. Those levels are extremely high. We have a strong westerly wind blowing everything out to sea, so we have clean air essentially and a normal background radiation. Thank you.
Tokyo's background radiation before 3.11 was 0.04 microsieverts per hour. Anything over 0.12 microsieverts per hour puts radiation doses at above the Japanese government's own pre-11 limit of 1 millisievert a year. Danieletto's reading itself plainly puts a Tokyo resident at an annual dose of 2.3 millisieverts, more than double the government's safety limit.
This means that people are safe from acute radiation syndrome, but not chronic radiation syndrome. That is, the myriad illnesses that can be brought on by accumulated radiation doses at low levels over a prolonged period of time, at which no level is deemed truly safe. Children are many more times sensitive to radiation than adults, and fetuses are even more susceptible. This, of course, does not account for the strontium in Tokyo tap water. No doubt, bioaccumulating in its residence, the radiation accumulating in the soil that Tokyo and North Japanese children have been ingesting during normal hand-to-mouth movements typical of day-to-day childhood play, nor the largely undetectable and invisible radioactive hot particles found in Tokyo car filters and air conditioners in 2011, suggesting to Dr. Chris Busby and nuclear scientist Arnie Gunderson that the average Tokyo resident breathed in 5 to 10 of these radioactive hot particles every day in the months after 3/11. Physicist Dr. Carl Morgan was a Manhattan Project scientist who turned against the nuclear power and nuclear weapons industry after being one of its most celebrated and staunchest adherents, when he discovered that even low radiation doses, such as those found in Tokyo, do indeed cause cancers and leukemia. He became one of the pioneers in the field of health physics, the science of recognizing, measuring, and controlling health hazards in the application of ionizing radiation. Danieletto was actually correct in a sense that the radiation level was perfectly safe. That is, for someone planning to live for only another 5, 10, 20 or 30 years, as these are the typical timeframes for the cancers and leukemias to appear, and as long as the wind never changed direction for the foreseeable future. Perhaps his fears were assuaged by the Japanese government raising the radiation safety limit from 1 to 20 millisieverts a year, only to have the limit revised back down to 1 millisievert at the angry behest of Japanese parents. The 1 millisievert a year level is predicated on the pre-311 understanding that even low radiation exposure can be deadly over time. Metropolis wisely placed in a disclaimer in their accompanying radiation article, stating that they are not nuclear science experts, and here it shows abundantly. What cannot be disclaimed is that the radiation is blowing out to the Pacific Ocean and on to North America, dismissively referred to as if it were of no consequence. Unfortunately, the consequences are real and tangible. In the time I have, I try to do brief radiation surveys across Tokyo, but the typhoon makes itself felt again, and the rains return for the remainder of the day. In Roppongi, Shinjuku, and Shimokitazawa, I find readings at the 0.11 to 0.12 microsievert level. I hypothesize that the typhoon is covering the tracks of the Fukushima radiation plume by blowing it away into the Pacific. It could have been that I found a little radiation hotspot in Ueno, and that would be all she wrote. I meet some friends that night and stay in Ikebukuro. Whatever radiation I find in the air, the Fukushima crisis seems to be morphing also into a crisis of water. In August 2013, the Japanese government will finally admit, and the New York Times will finally report, that 400 tons of radiation-contaminated water has been going into the Pacific Ocean daily since March 2011. In a bizarre reversal of events of 3/11, where a tsunami of seawater hit the Daiichi plant carrying debris inland, what has gone on since is subsurface groundwater from the mountains nearby has been naturally coming to the coastal nuclear plant, acting as a silent but menacing subterranean tsunami, as it is carrying with it the radioactive debris from the three melting down reactors, along with substantial leakages from the contaminant water storage tanks down into the Pacific Ocean. A barrier TEPCO built to stop the outflowing groundwater flow and pump it into storage has resulted in excess and errant groundwater welling up around the site, causing it to become marshy, more susceptible to submerging the three heavy meltdown reactor buildings and reactor 4 that houses 1,300, for the most part immovable, suspended fuel assemblies. TEPCO has only just started operations to remove these from the damaged building. That is in itself a very hazardous and time-intensive task. The fuel assemblies are tremendously heavy and are probably partially melted and distorted in parts, and still so hot, of course, that they must be encased in water at all times. A TEPCO spokesperson recently confessed that the company requires international assistance in light of its predicament, and the Japanese Nuclear Regulatory Agency head likened Daiichi to a house of horrors. This is, of course, made worse by the susceptibility of the area to further magnitude 7+ earthquakes and the unstable juncture of tectonic plates at which Japan itself sits, and the capacity for Japan to sink further should a comparable earthquake to 3.11 take place again. After the Fukushima accident in 2011, I contacted my Japanese friends, warning them that the government was covering up the true radiation situation. I did not receive many replies. One of my Tokyo residing friends, though, thanked me for my concern, but said that she had, quote, faith in Japanese technology to solve the problem, end quote. Faith is a wonderful thing, but that, and a too optimistic appreciation of technology, has ushered in a cyberpunk reality. Previously only imaginable in dystopian visions of writers like Philip K. Dick, Fukushima has delivered the tortured premise of cyberpunk, the promise of quote-unquote high-tech and low-life. The Japanese expression of this was birthed in films like Akira, where astounding and constant technological innovations have served to alienate the masses from one another, emitting vast oppressive conglomerates, colluding with massive overwrought government bureaucracies to rule over them and kettle them in similarly vast physical and psychological ghettos. The cyberpunk heroes are solitary, jaded protagonists who are often hackers, challenging the military and technological powers that be. Lawrence Person wrote that they are, quote, alienated loners living on the edge of society, in dystopic futures where daily life was impacted by rapid technological change, a ubiquitous data sphere of computerized information, and invasive modification of the human body. This cyberpunk realm is perhaps confirmed by the Japanese band World Order, whose music and choreography embodies the elegance, synergy, and possibility of technology, but at the same time also its impersonality, terrifying brutality, and even slippery treacherousness when interfaced with human subjects. A lyric of their track, Machine Civilization, asks, "Where is the world going? Won't somebody tell me?" A pertinent question, indeed. While television is obviously a terrifyingly amazing propaganda delivery vehicle for cyberpunk era dominant corporations backed by government compulsive force, it still reveals much of our true condition by what it sells and promotes. In my small hotel room in Ikebukuro, I see the media is currently in buzz in Japan also with the Edward Snowden story. Edward Snowden, who leaked that the US government is reading and storing emails, social media posts, and data of everyone on the planet. Another story is about the restart of the Ohi nuclear reactors being negotiated between Kansai Electric Power Company and the Japanese government. Apparently, the 2020 Tokyo Olympics bid is being pushed hard on the population as well. Lastly, there are constant and hair-splitting reports on the whereabouts, fallout and impact of the typhoon crossing Japan, but no such reports on Fukushima radiation and the mortality and death toll ensuing from it. Rainfall column graphs and charts and weather symbols should, in any normal return to sanity, be replaced by measurements and reportage, charting, radioactivity, hotspots and mutations, but they are conspicuously absent. Absent also is the ongoing push by the Abe government to remove Article 9 from the Constitution that forbids Japan to wage foreign wars or aggressive military conduct. Japan, like much of the rest of the world, is like these passengers, all fatigued from their exertions, earning units of printed, increasingly digitized currency, or going to re-education centers in preparation to earn that currency, but often finding refuge in their cyberpunk smartphones, soon to be replaced by Google Glass type interfaces, unaware or uncaring that they are being surveilled by their own devices, and unaware, really, of where the train is taking them, or who or what is in the driver's seat. Where we are headed is a dark world, permeated by massive nuclear contamination by air, land and sea, punctuated by escalating military conflict, probably culminating into a thermonuclear exchange, coupled with ubiquitous government, corporate surveillance of our activities in our homes, offices and work sites, with a terrifying, overarching, anti-terrorist apparatus, but that is aimed at us. Even mainstream media is reporting that Al-Qaeda is controlled by the US government, yet the same media outlets cannot in the same breath make the connection that 9/11 itself was a terrorist act perpetrated on the US by criminal cabals in the US government. In this world, there is much less need for manga or anime or science fiction to warn us of the potential dangers of dystopic future paradigms filled with fantastical pleasure and casual death. It is here now, ready for devouring. Fukushima and the government corporations who have force-fed us this cyberpunk world have delivered us the ultimate in macabre cosplay. All we have to do is don their costumes and play along until the plot dictates when our character should be killed off. Another pointer to where we are headed came in an unexpected form as I checked my smartphone for news of what my friends were doing back in Australia. A recently emigrated Bulgarian acquaintance of mine declares on social media that she is to cycle 200 kilometers to raise money for cancer research. Her family in Bulgaria, she says, has an unfortunate history or susceptibility to cancer, which she seeks to fight against. On April 26, 1986, Reactor 4 at Chernobyl nuclear power plant in the Ukraine, part of what was then the Soviet Union, melted down, releasing large quantities of radiation across the Western USSR and Europe. Chernobyl, compared to Fukushima, is a radioactive footnote. Its single and partial reactor meltdown will be lucky to be as high as 1/10 or 1/20 of the ongoing radiation release from Fukushima, where there are three larger reactors and are completely melting down as you speak. Nevertheless, Bulgaria is just one of the many European countries that is suffering an even now largely silent cancer epidemic in its aftermath. Radiation levels in Bulgaria in May 1986 were 1,000 times normal, and no precautions were recommended by the government. Spring salads were consumed as usual, and government reassurances were that no adverse health effects would be encountered. They were somewhat correct, but those assurances had an expiry date of 5 to 10 to 20 years. Birth defects and cancer rates are much higher than official government pronouncements even today in Bulgaria. In early 2012, the Bulgarian captain of English Premier League club Aston Villa, Stylian Petrov, was diagnosed with leukemia at the ripe old age of 32. His national team doctor unabashedly declared that this was due to the Chernobyl fallout in 1986 that is still recycling through the Bulgarian and European environment in trace elements that only reveal their presence perhaps a decade or so later. in the form of birth defects, cancers in the old and young. I think back to the children at Ueno, indeed all the children of Japan. Since Petrov was just 6 years old when Chernobyl melted down and spread a toxic radiation cloud all over Eastern Europe. These children may or may not exhibit any signs of ill effects from Fukushima for now, yet some already have. But Petrov lived in Montana, Bulgaria, some 650 miles from Chernobyl. And Ueno, and the whole of Tokyo, lies a mere 250 kilometers from Fukushima, with not one, but three completely melted down reactors. In a survey, Bulgarians voted that the Chernobyl accident was the most absurd episode in the country's history. Their own government acted completely against their own people's interests and covered up the radiation, and gave them little to no information, even when people became sick, and still underreports radiation-related illnesses to this day. It is an absurdity that is repeated historically, seemingly whenever and wherever there is a nuclear accident, just in different cultural paradigms. One could say that each nuclear accident is a Shakespearean tragedy, a tragedy with radioactive memes that transcends languages and cultural barriers with a deadly commonality of outcome. Each time the tragedy is performed, we see at many junctures in the plot that the protagonists always seemed to have the power to avoid the tragic ending, but choose not to. Each time we witness a nuclear tragedy like Windscale, Three Mile Island, Maralinga, Chernobyl, Fallujah, Fukushima, we know how the play ends. Every time. In great bloodshed. The same pattern is played out each time. Government and corporate denial. Silent releases of radiation. Media silence. And unaccountable illnesses and deaths in the populations affected. Just performed in different languages and accents on each occasion. Only Fukushima is by far the most lavish and thus most deadly tragedy to be put to the stage. Again, as if to answer world order, this is where we are going. Random, inexplicable, even sudden deaths, drastically shortened lives, more and more young adults and kids with cancers, children who should be bursting with vitality instead struck down with life-debilitating illnesses, miscarriages, destruction of our genetic code, and our lives. The fact that Fukushima radiation dwarfs Chernobyl only serves to bring the cancers and leukemias on much faster in an ever broader death toll on populations near and far from it. People may cycle as far as they wish and raise as much money for chemotherapy as they want, but the cancers are caused by the cesium and plutonium that is in the environment. Fallout from decades of atmospheric weapons testing in both hemispheres and nuclear accidents have played a major and unheralded and of course unpublicized part in the plague of cancers worldwide. Fukushima is, however, the one that trumps all previous accidents and radiation releases combined and is ongoing. What is more, Fukushima has a lot of nuclear plants worldwide that are seeking to challenge its title crown as the worst nuclear accident in history. A recent report stated that 91% of nuclear reactors across the globe are leaking. The typhoon is dispiriting to say the least. Nevertheless, it is hopefully for me blowing away any radiation and radioactive hot particles out to sea. But at the same time, that is what I'm hoping to find and measure. While I play these mind games with myself, some personal business has landed me in the nondescript residential town of Kananachi, on the eastern side of Tokyo. This is where high radiation levels have been discovered before, in nearby Matsudo and Kashiwa. With my errands done, I try some Geiger counter readings in a children's park. The airborne radiation here reads high, so now a soil reading. It strikes me that this could very well be considered sovereign Australian territory. The Australian government refuses to confirm or deny whether it supplied any of the uranium that fueled the melted down reactors at Fukushima, as it has a confidentiality agreement with its nuclear customers. I am standing on one cog of the nuclear fuel cycle where uranium is mined for civilian power generation in places like Australia, and then passed on for nuclear weapons production that ends up in nuclear missiles, or depleted uranium munitions that, when fired, cause horrible birth defects in Fallujah, Iraq, Serbia in the Yugoslavian Civil War, and in US veterans themselves that fire them in the broader war on terror. This radioactive patch here, for good or for bad, never made it to the Middle East to be used on Iraqi or Afghan men, women and children, however, and had to be content with living amidst Japanese persons in eastern Tokyo. As large cities go, Tokyo still has a phenomenally low incidence of crime. Young children, such as this young girl, can walk to and from school or cram school in generally perfect safety. And this was one of the factors that would win Tokyo the 2020 Olympics in September. But what really menaces her and Tokyo at large from 3/11 onward is the silent stalker of ionizing radiation present in enough air, water, soil, food, and even in the advertising to bring on a devastating public health crisis in the years to come. My time in Tokyo is running out. I'm already missing this place. I ensure that I have enough time to survey one last place, Ebisu, that I have a particular fascination with. Every Christmas, Ebisu Garden Place has an illuminated chandelier as its centerpiece. Today it has been taken over by Honda Corporation. They are showcasing their latest hybrid motor car that promises to reduce CO2 emissions. Overlooking the car below from a mezzanine, I set up for one last reading before I meet friends briefly and set off back to Nara. There is ionizing radiation even here, with the typhoon in full swing. It looks to have made its mark here in Ebisu. The United Nations has declared that CO2 emissions are creating dead zones in oceans, poisoning rivers and drinking water, as well as changing the climate. It is beyond incompetence and negligence that the very same organization cannot see this poison present before me. Carbon dioxide that is breathed in by plants to create oxygen, and not the radiation, is what we are told is the bane of our existence and the greatest threat to our environment. How the radiation will affect those unknowing, or those dismissive of its long-term health effects, even in low doses, only time will really tell. What is disturbing is the number of radiation sicknesses that have arisen in little time that has expired since March 11. With cesium levels in Tokyo now confirmed to be much higher than previously thought, and cesium levels in Tokyo tap water confirmed to be as high, if not higher, than Fukushima, I recall a couple I know who left Tokyo for the United States a month earlier. Their 3-year-old child developed restrictive cardiomyopathy, where the heart does not beat nor circulate blood properly. The cause of such a life-debilitating condition is, according to medical authorities, not known. Those who have studied Chernobyl victims and the fallout's effects on children's hearts there point to radioactive cesium as being the cause. When speaking of Fukushima's multiple meltdowns, this is Chernobyl again, but written this time on a vast global canvas, many, many times larger. Arriving back in Nara, I hand back my Geiger counter to a friend who had lent it to me. On my last full day in Kansai, I'm meeting an old friend at Kyoto Botanical Garden, as I get slaughtered in rock, scissors, paper by her 4-year-old daughter over lunch. I think intermittently about what I found at the garden entrance a few moments before. The gardens are beautiful and elegant, with families enjoying a rainless Sunday afternoon together. Just like in Eiko's neighborhood in South Kyoto, there are no signs here of any radiation mutations that came in April. Those mutated plants, I assume, either withered away or have been culled, except for these two. On my last day, I have found a tangible sign of Fukushima in Kyoto. I have no Geiger counter now, but I am in lesser need of it. I can see the radiation with my own eyes now. Eiko had told me in general that Japanese people don't want to talk about the radiation, so I make no mention of the flower. Again, talking about the radiation would seem, in the eyes of most Japanese generally, as a form of unwarranted complaining about things that cannot be changed, like the weather. Rain, they say in Japan, builds character, and radiation, it would seem, is judged to do the same. Back in Kanamachi, Tokyo, I spoke briefly to an elderly lady about her feelings about the situation and if she saw any change in the environment. Shoganai is a Japanese expression as predictable as the sun coming up in the morning. It summarizes the current majority of Japanese thinking towards Fukushima and the radiation. Many of my Japanese acquaintances are evasive on the subject, let alone my non-Japanese friends, who truly regard Fukushima and 311 as ancient history. It has even estranged me from many of them, as if radiation is a word not to be spoken or uttered, in a kind of cultural or commercial self-censorship, myopia or denial, whatever one wishes to call it. Eiko tells me that the most belligerent Japanese in the face of Fukushima radiation are young mothers. For her, Japanese men have abdicated their responsibility as protectors of the household and of the nation, as they often toe the company line and the government line and go along with official pronouncements. In this current state of affairs, we are merely encouraged to remain stationary witnesses to a grand murder, the murder of Kyoto. It is tempting to over-romanticize Stimson's sparing of Kyoto from incendiary and atomic destruction. Stimson reportedly hated war as he was a World War I veteran. He was, however, a distinguished member of the notorious Skull and Bones Society from Yale, no doubt providing powerful contacts and privileges in his rise to ever more prestigious and lucrative positions. Skull and Bones' philosophy is infamous for double-crossing other parties, doublespeak, and the brutal application of military force in order to achieve objectives. Stimson oversaw the targeting and bombing of civilians during World War II. His sparing of Kyoto seems not to be so much the work of a political angel, but rather that of a concentration camp commandant, not executing a prisoner whose appearance reminded him of a dear and close relative. The bombing of cities was a means to a greater end. In directing and nurturing the Manhattan Project to create the bomb, he saw an opportunity to use the destructive power of the atom to usher in or force-feed the world an era of new nuclear-powered security, where aggressors could be deterred or destroyed by this righteous weapon under an umbrella of American dominance. Stimson believed that the technology could be controlled. Technology can indeed be a wonderful benefit to us all, yet Fukushima is the latest and greatest example of how it can become like Tolkien's Ring of Power. It has come to be wielded with not merely reckless but also tyrannical abandon by an untouchable corporate military elite that propagandizes it to be infallible and ever beneficial.
What market forces and the kind of concentration of the global mafia has been able to do is to produce such an enormously powerful military and nuclear orientated structure that it's possible to choose scientists and to pay those scientists that you want to tell you the things that you want to hear. And terrible things can happen, because then they can acquire around themselves other people like themselves, and then you end up with a situation which is monolithic and virtually impossible to deal with. What we have now is something that is almost universal and global. All of these things have conspired together to increase the concentration of radionuclides in the environment to a level where it is now threatening life on Earth.
After the atomic bombing of Hiroshima on August 6, 1945, Stimson issued a statement from the War Department to explain the use of the bomb and heralding its creation as being the culmination of years of Herculean effort on the part of science and industry working in cooperation with the military authorities. He thanked the corporations, too numerous to mention exhaustively, but singled out a few: Union Carbide, DuPont, Kellogg, Chrysler, General Electric, and Westinghouse. One of the companies he was remiss to mention also was Monsanto, as it was crucial in the uranium enrichment process. It is these corporations today that are dominant players in the military-industrial complex that has taken over the reins of the US government. Stimson in 1945 probably never saw the cyberpunk era that he helped bring about coming in and usurping his utopian visions. Then again, maybe he knew all along about what would arise from it. We can't know for sure. It is apparent that the technology and the output it discharges is being used against us for the benefit of the few, leaving many, many minions alienated, divided, contaminated and dying, often unknowingly, and surveilled constantly, with brutal state violence ready to pounce should anyone seriously challenge it. If we cannot challenge the cyberpunk corruption manifested in the Fukushima cover-up, the radiation raids on Kyoto will continue. It will come from the nuclear waste incineration that will make the city more and more radioactive. It is coming from the constant radiation leakages at Daiichi that threaten the whole of Japan and the Northern Hemisphere at large. It can easily come from the broader regional or global thermonuclear exchange, as the Japanese government is seeking to overturn its own non-aggression stance and is verbally sparring and shadowboxing with China and North Korea, in tandem with the broader worsening situation in Syria and Iran being stirred up by the Obama administration and the CIA. In nurturing the Manhattan Project, the Fukushima tragedy has ironically revealed the folly of Stimson's imperial idealism in believing that nuclearism could usher in a new era of peace by deterring aggressors. Stimson helped create the nuclear-armed military-industrial complex that threatens to destroy his city today. His wartime subordinate, Dwight Eisenhower, one of his protégés he molded and nurtured, became president in 1953 and created the IAEA, a UN body tasked with promoting nuclear power and therefore loath to ever condemn or act against the nuclear industry, even post-Fukushima. Yet Eisenhower, at the end of his tenure in 1961, saw some of the light and contemplated the enormity of the monster he inherited from Stimson and Truman, that he himself gave further sustenance.
We must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex. The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist. We must never let the weight of this combination endanger our liberties or democratic processes. For every old blackboard, there are now hundreds of new electronic computers. The prospect of domination of the nation's scholars by federal employment, project allocations, and the power of money is ever present and is gravely to be regarded. We must also be alert to the equal and opposite danger that public policy could itself become the captive of a scientific technological elite.
Eisenhower, like Stimson, helped unleash the nuclear genie, and now in Fukushima it is well and truly out of control. We find that the corporate-driven imperial aggression of the military-industrial complex, like the Pacific fallout itself, is similarly out of control.
This is about the large-scale, indiscriminate use of weapons that the civilized world long ago decided must never be used at all. I went back and I watched the videos that anybody can watch in the social media. It is really hard to express in words the human suffering that they lay out before us. The images of entire families dead in their beds without a drop of blood or even a visible wound. Bodies contorting in spasms. Human suffering that we can never ignore or forget. Our sense of basic humanity is offended not only by this cowardly crime, but also by the cynical attempt to cover it up. What is before us today is real, and it is compelling. So I also want to underscore that while investigators are gathering additional evidence on the ground, our understanding of what has already happened in Syria is grounded in facts, informed by conscience, and guided by common sense. Make no mistake, President Obama believes there must be accountability for those who would use the world's most heinous weapons against the world's most vulnerable people. Nothing today is more serious, and nothing is receiving more serious scrutiny.
Hiroshima was the first target of this complex, and in 2013, the candidates seemed to be Syria and Iran to come. The complex may just start a thermonuclear confrontation with Russia and China in the process. We probably could not imagine that we could be culpable in any of this. Yet we are not bystanding innocents, because this is our world too. Or is it? The preservation of Kyoto is of course allegorical for all that is precious in this world and rightful of our protection. If we cannot overturn what is going on, then we are culpable in its and our own destruction. A visit to Todaiji Temple, just south of Kyoto, in Nara, is a perennial rite of passage for almost every Japanese schoolchild. Buses bring school groups here from across Japan almost daily. Within the temple is a huge stone Buddha. Behind it, on the right, stands one of the large pillars with a narrow passage in its base. It is believed that if one is able to squeeze oneself completely through to the other side of the pillar, then enlightenment is attained. The children manage it easily, with a commemorative photo to boot, but the adults often struggle to do it so easily. After the tragedy of 3/11, a Japanese boy was reported to have said to his mother, "Why don't we just arrest the earthquake?" As silly and naive as this may initially sound, it may just be real thinking outside the box, or even a thought truly born of enlightenment, of one who has crawled through the hollow Todaiji pillar, or perhaps both. The boy probably thought the idea to be perfectly logical. He has no fear of embarrassment, or loss of face, or credibility that adults are petrified of. If applied to the Fukushima nuclear disaster, we find that we already know the people who are publicly responsible for the preconditions that permitted the accident to occur, and those who are continuing the policies that are irradiating Kyoto, Japan, and the globe. They are public figures and public companies. We know they committed crimes and are committing crimes that are killing and sickening people. Why can't we arrest them? The boy is probably still asking, so we can all get on with our lives. We could probably give him a lot of good adult reasons why it is we cannot arrest them. But in the face of the people who have died, and the many millions that will die, and the irradiation of the planet for thousands of years, if policy is not immediately and drastically changed, and an international task force brought in place of TEPCO to mitigate the horrific problems at Daiichi. Probably none of our rationalized reasons would constitute a real excuse for not accosting those we know or deeply suspect to be guilty of radiation murders and manslaughter, and acting to undo as best we can the dreadful harm that they have done. Eisenhower at least provided something of a way out of this, though he himself was a member of Bohemian Grove, where the very idea of the atomic bomb was first planned in 1942, hinting at the collusion of powerful banking and corporate forces behind the bomb's creation. He nevertheless warned the American public in his farewell speech that only a knowledgeable and alert citizenry was capable of keeping the terrible power of this military-industrial complex in check and keep it subservient to the needs of the public. Any quick reality check today will easily bear out that a mere handful of corporations own the mainstream media in America. GE even has its own media conglomerate in MSNBC, and rampant infiltration into the White House and the Department of Energy. We find today that the military-industrial complex and its military entertainment complex arm have propagated an alert and knowledgeable public, but overwhelmingly focused on these areas of expertise. Only a truly alert and knowledgeable citizenry, indeed, can compel the truth of what is occurring at Fukushima to be exposed and demand a credible international task force be assembled to deal with it. Before we leave Kyoto, perhaps we should visit one last place together. Kinkakuji Temple, the Golden Pavilion, draws hordes of visitors contemplative of its perfected beauty. In 1950, a young monk reportedly became so enamored and obsessed by it that he set fire to it, destroying it completely. We find that our Secretary of War was not so much different, as his apparent affection for Kyoto compelled him to seek a rapid, all-powerful nuclear solution to end all wars that had threatened to obliterate it. Yet his powerful nuclear asset has become deeply corrupt and has metastasized into unchecked and all-powerful corporate leviathans collusively backed by the United Nations and the banking families that created it, waging an undeclared nuclear war of global fallout and contamination on the Earth's peoples by means myriad and beyond even nuclear. They leverage their wealth and power on the destruction of the health and liberties of these people. Their success depends on our degradation and elimination. Those invested in depleted uranium and nuclear energy, for example, figures as publicly visible as the Queen of England and Bill Gates, cannot be bargained with. Their philosophy of domination demands that eugenics be carried out. The people of Fukushima, Tokyo, North America, indeed the whole Northern Hemisphere, you see, must take this radiation hit. They must be sacrificed in silence so their abhorrent system of technological eugenics can live. They are the food upon which the military-industrial complex system is designed to feed. Now it is this power, the nuclear and corporate military power, agglomerated originally in the Manhattan Project, Stimson's power, that we must seek to eradicate if his city is to be preserved and we are to live. If there is no change, then we are aiding and abetting the bombing of Kyoto. If there is no change, then we may as well be co-pilot or bombardier on a modern-day flight of B-29s, participating through passivity in the radioactive bombing of ourselves and our own progeny. This time we have to save Kyoto ourselves. There is no Stimson to countermand our bombing orders. There are millions of us who profess to love Kyoto's beauty and history, and billions of us who profess to cherish this planet. If we cannot be moved to change our course, then the world below us will be changed to one that we can no longer inhabit. The truth of what is happening at Fukushima, and now, by extension, what is happening in Syria, can only be effective if it and the movements that are trying to expose these truths deploy out of cyberspace and into physical spaces and becomes pervasive, ubiquitous, and visible. so as to point the finger at the radiation that is invisible, but is nevertheless spreading throughout the Pacific Ocean and the Northern Hemisphere, and to indict and to put to trial the persons, corporations, and collusions that are responsible for the ongoing radiation of the biosphere and the threat of thermonuclear war. We don't have very much time, as our plane will be over the target soon. It really is now or never. Beyond the din of the engines, high in the cloud as we are, we have to remember and base our decisions on the value of the life, the lives of myriad sentient beings in ecosystems that stirs below, to guide how we respond in this crucial episode in the future of our planet. We know where this plot in the Fukushima tragedy ends. We've seen this play before. The outcome we know, but the outcome can be whatever we want it to be, if we are strong enough, and if what good remains in this world is worth saving. Thank you.